Parashat Behaalotecha, Numbers 8:1 through 12:16. God spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to Aaron and say to him, 'When you mount the lamps, let the seven lamps give light at the front of the lampstand.'" Aaron did so. He mounted the lamps at the front of the lampstand as God had commanded Moses. Now, this is how the lampstand was made. It was hammered work of gold, hammered from base to petal. According to the pattern that God had shown Moses, so was the lampstand made. God spoke to Moses, saying, "Take the Levites from among the Israelites and purify them." This is what you shall do to them to purify them. Sprinkle on them water of purification, let them go over their whole body with a razor, and wash their clothes. Thus they shall be purified. Let them take a bull of the herd, and with it a meal offering of choice flour with oil mixed in, and you take a second bull of the herd for a sin offering. You shall bring the Levites forward before the tent of meeting. Assemble the Israelite community leadership and bring the Levites forward before God. Let the Israelites lay their hands upon the Levites, and let Aaron designate the Levites before God as an elevation offering from the Israelites, that they may perform the service of God. The Levites shall now lay their hands upon the heads of the bulls. One shall be offered to God as a sin offering, and the other as a burnt offering to make expiation for the Levites. You shall place the Levites in attendance upon Aaron and his sons and designate them as an elevation offering to God. Thus, you shall set the Levites apart from the Israelites, and the Levites shall be mine.
Second reading. Thereafter, the Levites shall be qualified for the service of the tent of meeting, once you have purified them and designated them as an elevation offering. For they are formally assigned to me from among the Israelites. I have taken them for myself, in place of all the first issue of the womb and of all the male firstborn of the Israelites. For every male firstborn among the Israelites, human as well as beast, is mine. I consecrated them to myself at the time that I smote every male firstborn in the land of Egypt. Now I take the Levites instead of every male firstborn of the Israelites. And from among the Israelites, I formally assign the Levites to Aaron and his sons to perform the service for the Israelites in the tent of meeting and to make expiation for the Israelites, so that no plague may affect the Israelites for coming too near the sanctuary. Moses, Aaron, and the Israelite community leadership did with the Levites accordingly, just as Hashem had commanded Moses in regard to the Levites. So the Israelites did with them. The Levites purified themselves and washed their clothes, and Aaron designated them as an elevation offering before Hashem, and Aaron made expiation for them to purify them. Thereafter, the Levites were qualified to perform their service in the tent of meeting under Aaron and his sons. As Hashem had commanded Moses in regard to the Levites, so did they do to him. Hashem spoke to Moses, saying, "This is the rule of the Levites. From 25 years of age up, they shall participate in the workforce in the service of the tent of meeting. But at the age of 50, they shall retire from the workforce and shall serve no more. They may assist their brother Levites, the tent of meeting, by standing guard, but they shall perform no labor. Thus you shall deal with the Levites in regard to their duties."
Third Aliyah. Hashem spoke to Moses in the wilderness of Sinai on the first new moon of the second year following the Exodus from the land of Egypt, saying, "Let the Israelite people offer the Passover sacrifice at its set time. You shall offer it on the 14th day of this month at twilight. At its set time, you shall offer it in accordance with all its rules and rites." Moses instructed the Israelites to offer the Passover sacrifice, and they offered the Passover sacrifice in the first month, on the 14th day of the moon month, at twilight, in the wilderness of Sinai. Just as Hashem had commanded Moses, so the Israelites did. But there were some householders who were impure by reason of a corpse and could not offer the Passover sacrifice on that day. Appearing that same day before Moses and Aaron, these householders said to them, "Impure though we are by reason of a corpse, why must we be debarred from presenting Hashem's offering at its set time with the rest of the Israelites?" Moses said to them, "Stand by and let me hear what instructions Hashem gives about you." And Hashem spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to the Israelite people, saying, when at any party, whether you or your posterity, who is defiled by a corpse or is on a long journey, would offer a Passover sacrifice to Hashem, they shall offer it in the second month, on the 14th day of the month, at twilight. They shall eat it with unleavened bread and bitter herbs, and they shall not leave any of it over until morning. They shall not break a bone of it. They shall offer it in strict accord with the law of the Passover sacrifice. But if any party who is pure and not on a journey refrains from offering the Passover sacrifice, that person shall be cut off from kin, for Hashem's offering was not presented at its set time. That party shall bear the guilt. And when a stranger who resides with you would offer a Passover sacrifice to Hashem, it must be offered in accordance with the rules and rites of the Passover sacrifice. There shall be one law for you, whether stranger or citizen of the country."
Fourth Aliyah. On the day that the tabernacle was set up, the cloud covered the tabernacle, the tent of pact, and in the evening it rested over the tabernacle in the likeness of fire until morning. It was also so, the cloud covered it, appearing as fire by night. And whenever the cloud lifted from the tent, the Israelites would set out accordingly, and at the spot where the cloud settled, there the Israelites would make camp. At a command of God, the Israelites broke camp, and at a command of God, they made camp. They remained encamped as long as the cloud stayed over the tabernacle. When the cloud lingered over the tabernacle many days, the Israelites observed God's mandate and did not journey on. At such times as the cloud rested over the tabernacle for but a few days, they remained encamped at a command of God and broke camp at a command of God. And at such times as the cloud stayed from evening until morning, they broke camp as soon as the cloud lifted in the morning. Day or night, whenever the cloud lifted, they would break camp. Whether it was 2 days or a month or a year, however long the cloud lingered over the tabernacle, the Israelites remained encamped and did not set out. Only when it lifted did they break camp. On a sign from God, they made camp, and on a sign from God, they broke camp. They observed God's mandate at God's bidding through Moses. God spoke to Moses, saying, "Have two silver trumpets made. Make them of hammered work. They shall serve you to summon military bodies of the community and to set the divisions in motion. When both are blown in long blasts, the whole company of fighters shall assemble before you at the entrance of the tent of meeting. And if only one is blown, the chieftains, head of Israel's contingents, shall assemble before you. But when you sound short blasts, the divisions encamped on the east shall move forward. And when you sound short blasts a second time, those encamped on the south shall move forward. Thus short blasts shall be blown for setting them in motion. While to convoke military bodies of the congregation, you shall blow long blasts, not short ones. The trumpets shall be blown by Aaron's sons, the priests. They shall be for you an institution for all time throughout the ages. When you are at war in your land against an aggressor who attacks you, you shall sound short blasts on the trumpets, that you may be remembered before your God, Adonai, and be delivered from your enemies. And on your joyous occasions, your fixed festivals and new moon days, you shall sound the trumpets over your burnt offerings and your sacrifices of well-being. They shall be a reminder of you before your God. I, Adonai, am your God."
Fifth Aliyah. In the second year, on the 20th day of the second month, the cloud lifted from the tabernacle of the path, and the Israelites set out on their journeys from the wilderness of Sinai. The cloud came to rest in the wilderness of Paran. When the march was to begin, at Hashem's command through Moses, the first standard to set out, troop by troop, was the division of Judah. In command of its troops was Nashan, son of Amminadab. In command of the tribal troop of Issachar, Nathaniel, son of Zur. And in command of the tribal troop of Zebulun, Eliab, son of Helion. Then the tabernacle would be taken apart, and the Gershonites and the Merarites, who carried the tabernacle, would set out. The next standard to set out, troop by troop, was the division of Reuben. In command of its troop was Eleazar, son of Shedir. In command of the tribal troop of Simeon, Shelumiel, son of Zurishaddai. And in command of the tribal troop of Gad, Eliasaph, son of Deuel. Then the Kohathites, who carried the sacred objects, would set out, and by the time they arrived, the tabernacle would be set up again. The next standard to set out, troop by troop, was the division of Ephraim. In command of its troop was Elishama, son of Ammihud. And in command of the tribal troop of Manasseh, Gamliel, son of Pedahazar, and in command of the tribal troop of Benjamin, Abidan, son of Gideoni. Then, as a rear guard of all the divisions, the standard of the division of Dan would be set out, troop by troop. In command of its troop was Ahiezer, son of Amishaddai. In command of the tribal troop of Asher, Pagiel, son of Ochron. And in command of the tribal troop of Naphtali, Ahira, son of Enon. Such was the order of the march of the Israelites, as they marched troop by troop. Moses said to Hobab, son of Reuel the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law, "We are setting out for the place of which Hashem has said, 'I will give it to you.' Come with us, and we will be generous with you, for Hashem has promised to be generous to Israel." "I will not go," he replied to him, "but will return to my native land." He said, "Please do not leave us, inasmuch as you know where we should camp in the wilderness and can be our guide. So if you come with us, we will extend to you the same bounty that Hashem grants us." They marched from the mountain of Hashem a distance of 3 days. The Ark of the Covenant of Hashem traveled in front of them on that 3 days' journey to seek a resting place for them, and Hashem's clouds kept above them by day as they moved on from camp.
Sixth Aliyah. When the Ark was to set out, Moses would say, "Advance, O Hashem, may your enemies be scattered, and may your foes flee before you." And when it halted, he would say, "Return, O Hashem, you who are Israel's myriads of thousands." The people took to complaining bitterly before Hashem. Hashem heard and was incensed. A fire of Hashem broke out amongst them, ravaging the outskirts of the camp. The people cried out to Moses. Moses prayed to Hashem, and the fire died down. That place was named Taberah, because a fire of Hashem had broken out against them. The riffraff in their midst felt a gluttonous craving. And then the Israelites wept and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish that we used to eat free in Egypt, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. Now our gullets are shriveled. There is nothing at all, nothing but this manna to look to." Now the manna was like coriander seed, and in color it was like dillium. The people would go out and gather it, grind it between millstones, or pound it in a mortar, boil it in a pot, and make it into cakes. It tasted like rich cream. When the dew fell on the camp at night, the manna would fall upon it. Moses heard the people weeping, every clan apart at the entrance of each tent. Hashem was very angry, and Moses was distressed. And Moses said to Hashem, "Why have you dealt ill with your servant, and why have I not enjoyed your favor that you have laid the burden of all this people upon me? Did I produce all these people? Did I engender them that you should say to me, 'Carry them in your bosom as a caregiver carries an infant to the land that you have promised on oath to their fathers'? Where am I to get meat to give all this people when they whine before me and say, 'Give us meat to eat'? I cannot carry all this people by myself, for it is too much for me. If you would deal thus with me, kill me rather, I beg you, and let me see no more of my wretchedness." Then Hashem said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 of Israel's elders, of whom you have experience, as elders and officers of the people, and bring them to the tent of meeting, and let them take their place there with you. I will come down and speak with you there, and I will draw upon the spirit that is on you, and put it upon them. They shall share the burden of the people with you, and you shall not bear it alone. And say to the people, 'Purify yourselves for tomorrow, and you shall eat meat. For you have kept whining before Hashem and saying, "If only we had meat to eat. Indeed, we were better off in Egypt." Hashem will give you meat, and you shall eat. You shall eat not one day, not two, not even 5 days or 20, but a whole month, until it comes out of your nostrils and becomes loathsome to you. For you have rejected Hashem, who is among you, by whining before Hashem and saying, "Oh, why did we ever leave Egypt?" But Moses said, "The people who are with me number 600,000 foot soldiers. Yet you say, 'I will give them enough meat to eat for a whole month.' Could enough flocks and herds be slaughtered to suffice them? Or could all the fish of the sea be gathered for them to suffice them?" And Hashem answered Moses, "Is there a limit to Hashem's power? You shall soon see whether what I have said happens to you or not." Moses went out and reported the words of Hashem to the people. He gathered 70 of the people's elders and stationed them around the tent. Then, after coming down in a cloud and speaking to him, Hashem drew upon the spirit that was on him and put it upon the 70 participating elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they spoke in ecstasy, but did not continue. Two of the participants, one named Eldad and the other Medad, had remained in camp. Yet the spirit rested upon them. They were among those recorded, but they had not gone out to the tent, and they spoke in ecstasy in the camp. An assistant ran out and told Moses, saying, "Eldad and Medad are acting the prophet in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant from his youth, spoke up and said, "My lord Moses, restrain them." But Moses said to him, "Are you wrought upon my account? Would that all Hashem's people were prophets, that Hashem put the divine spirit upon them?"
Seventh Aliyah. Moses then re-entered the camp together with the elders of Israel. A wind from God started up, swept quail from the sea, and strewed them over the camp, about a day's journey on this side and about a day's journey on that side, all around the camp and some 2 cubits deep on the ground. The people set to gathering quail all that day and night and all the next day. Even the ones who gathered least had 10 homers, and they spread them out all around camp. The meat was still between their teeth, not yet chewed, when the anger of God blazed forth against the people, and God struck the people with a very severe plague. That place was named Kibroth Hatavah, because the people who had the craving were buried there. Then the people set out from Kibroth Hatavah for Hazerot. When they were in Hazerot, Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Cushite woman he had taken into his household as his wife. "He took a Cushite woman?" they said. "Has God spoken only through Moses? Has God not spoken through us as well?" God heard it. Now Moses himself was very humble, more so than any other human being on earth. Suddenly, God called to Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, "Come out, you three, to the tent of meeting." So the three of them went out. God came down in a pillar of cloud, stopped at the entrance of the tent, and called out, Aaron and Miriam. The two of them came forward, and God said, Hear these my words. When prophets of God arise among you, I make myself known to them in a vision. I speak with them in a dream. Not so with my servant Moses. He is trusted throughout my household. With him I speak mouth to mouth, plainly and not in riddles, and he beholds the likeness of God. How then did you not shrink from speaking against my servant Moses? Still incensed with him, God departed. As the cloud withdrew from the tent, there was Miriam stricken with snow-white scales. When Aaron turned toward Miriam, he saw that she was stricken with scales. And Aaron said to Moses, Oh, my Lord, account not to us the sin which we committed in our folly. Let her not be like a stillbirth which emerges from its mother's womb with half its flesh eaten away. So Moses cried out to God, saying, Oh God, pray, heal her. But God said to Moses, If her father spat in her face, would she not bear her shame for 7 days? Let her be shut out of camp for 7 days, and then let her be readmitted. So Miriam was shut out of camp 7 days, and the people did not march on until Miriam was readmitted. After that, the people set out from Hazeroth and encamped in the wilderness of Paran.